All right, for the rest of class, we're going to go back to doing volumes. On Monday, we did both areas and volumes. Today, we're just doing volumes. Two kinds of examples I want to do today. A volume for a solid of revolution and a volume of a solid that's got what's called a fixed cross-section shape. Of a given shape for the cross-section. So let's do the volume of revolution first. Your art skills are kind of tested with this stuff, but give it your best shot. Let's imagine we've got the graph of y equals x squared here, and I'm purposely going to make the scales on the axes a little different so that I can draw it better. So that's going to be x equals 2, and 2 squared is 4. This is going to be y equals 4. And I'm going to take the area or the region under the graph of x squared between 0 and 2, and I'm going to rotate it around the x-axis. Of course, you have to do such a thing in your imagination. What will you get if you do such a thing in your imagination? You can try to draw it. I usually start over here and imagine rotating this point around the axis. If I go all the way around the x-axis, that's going to describe a circle. But wait a minute, that doesn't look like a circle. It looks like an oval, an ellipse. Well, you have to imagine it with perspective, three-dimensional perspective. This part of the circle is in front of the paper, and this part is behind the paper in your imagination. And everything else is going to do something similar, except the circles are going to be smaller. And in the end, the solid you're going to get will look something about like this. It'll be like a horn. Fun, fun, fun. And you can try to add some shading in here to emphasize the nature of the solid. Like you're blowing into a horn. What's our goal? Our goal is to find the volume of this thing. It's not a typical kind of cone. Like on Monday, we had a cone where the sides were, you know, straight. These sides are curved. The answer is not 1/3 pi r squared h. It's not that, because of the curvature of the sides here. But the approach that we used on Monday still works. We want to slice this into thin slices where the cross sections, once again, look like thin wafers, thin hockey pucks, if you prefer. So how should I slice it? Should I slice it this way? No, because I rotated around the x-axis, slice it perpendicular to the x-axis. Imagine my hand as a knife, slice it perpendicular to the x-axis. What is a typical thin slice going to look like? Oh, maybe about like this. Might be a typical thin slice of a certain width. Maybe I should call the width a delta x. Yeah, in general, delta x means change in x, and that could be thought of that way here, but I'm also imagining this to be very small. 0.1, 0.01. You could even go more extreme and say 10 to the negative 100 power, 10 to the negative a million power, which is impossible to draw on any ordinary scale. You could go hog wild in your imagination. That thin slice, that wafer, that really thin hockey puck has got a certain very small volume. Why very small volume? Because the width is very small. Call it delta V for the volume of that. Big picture wise, I'm saying the total volume of this cone shape is going to be the sum of these little volumes. And that sum is going to like magically morph into an integral, in our imaginations at least. But how do I do this? Where do I go from here? I'm going to label this position on the x-axis of this thin slice with an x as well. If I was trying to be maybe a little bit more rigorous, I'd maybe label it x sub I and imagine that I've partitioned the interval into a bunch of subintervals, and maybe x sub I represents the right endpoint of the ith subinterval. But remember, in the big picture, we're just trying to get to an integral anyway. We're not really trying to approximate the integral with a Riemann sum, unless we had to. So being a little extra careful here is maybe not worth the trouble. So I'm not going to bother calling it x sub I. Let's call it x. Is it okay that if I have x's in two spots? I mean, it's not a big deal. That's just the label for the axis. That's a particular number. What is delta v? It's a thin wafer, thin hockey puck, thin cylinder. Formula for the volume of a cylinder is pi r squared times h. Pi times the radius squared times the height. But wait a minute, is this really a cylinder? I drew these sides to be horizontal here, right where I'm showing you here, here and here. But the solid has curved sides. That's why this is an approximation. But it's a better and better approximation the smaller delta x is. Pi r squared times delta x. Delta x is the height of the cylinder, although the cylinder is on its side, so it's a sideways height. R is the radius. Can I draw R in here? I could try. Maybe something about like that, though that's hard to tell what that is. That's supposed to be a line from the center of the circle here to the edge. That's R. Might be better to draw it head on, or maybe draw it in a separate little drawing here. Here's our thin wafer. Imagine this with perspective. It's like a wheel going into the screen here. This is the front of the wheel closest to you. That's the side, the back of the wheel furthest from you. There's a center to the wheel and there's a certain radius. And then we could also imagine our eye being over here. This is an eye here. I'm drawing an eye. You're looking at it head on so that the cross section looks like a circle. And then it truly looks like a radius. This is an eye here. You can label it my eye if you like, your eye, whatever. But wait, what's going on here exactly? Am I going to integrate that? Pi r squared dx? Isn't that a constant? The answer is no, r is not constant. It's a function of x. Different x's give you different radii. The closer x is to 2, the bigger the radius is. The radius of this circle is really big. The radius of a circle over here is really small. R depends on x. R is a function of x. I do know I ultimately want to integrate with respect to x because the x has the delta in front of it. So I need to figure out how things depend on x. It's easier than it might look at first. Does anybody think they know how R depends on x? R equals what function of x? Go ahead. X squared. Yeah, how? Because that's what this graph is. Y equals x squared. And for this given value of x, One more color. What do I have left? Blue. I'm using purple. Okay, here's a blue one. The distance from this line to that graph is the y-coordinate in terms of x. That's x squared. And that is the same as the radius of the circle, of the disk. R equals x squared here. That sounds strange to say. But that's what it is. And therefore, the tiny volume is pi times x to the fourth times delta x. Seems strange to say a volume involves x to the fourth. But it's only because of the nature of the graph that we rotated around. If the graph, by the way, were x cubed, then we'd be squaring x cubed and get x to the sixth. If the graph were y equal x to the fourth, we'd be squaring x to the fourth and get x to the eighth. I mean, if you're worried about units, the units of x squared are really the same as the units of y, which is just length units. Even though the function is x squared, and x is in centimeters, y is in centimeters too. I mean, yes, you'd have to make it truly rigorous, you'd have to have a constant of proportionality here, whose units were one over units of length to make sure it canceled correctly. But it's just worrying about that kind of stuff is just too far gone. Okay, don't go there. Don't worry too much about the units until the very end. Just put the units on at the very end. If the units of length are centimeters, the final answer is going to be cubic centimeters. And don't worry about the stuff in between, at least now. There probably will be some times in section 8.4 and 8.5, I believe, when we're doing some physics applications related to work done by a force. Yikes. Work done by a force where it probably will be beneficial to think carefully about units. But here, it's probably not worth the trouble. Anyway, the total volume of the solid, then, the entire solid, is the sum of the little volumes, which would be approximately the sum of these things, pi x to the fourth times delta x. And then here's where the magic happens. Let delta x go to zero. And the summation magically morphs into an integral sign. And the delta x magically morphs into a dx. And we get the exact correct final answer. The approximately equal sign morphs into an equal sign. The total volume is exactly the integral of pi times x to the fourth dx, where you do need to choose appropriate limits of integration. Go back to the picture, x goes from 0 to 2. And that is the exact volume. How can all this hand-wavy math give us something so sure? Equals, exactly. In part, the justification is based on the fact that these Riemann sums become better and better approximations to the volume as delta x goes to zero. It's really more of a definition. It's not really something to prove. It's more that we're defining this to be the volume. Now, you'd have to actually, in reality, see if theoretical volume approached this way matches actual physical volume by taking your object and, like, you know, putting it in a bathtub and seeing how much the water level goes up, and does it match the theory? Maybe not perfectly, because the solid could be porous, but close enough. Now just do that integral. Get pi over 5 x to the fifth going from 0 to 2, and that's going to be 2 to the fifth is 32. 32 pi over 5 is the volume. And that is about 20.1 cubic units of length. So if length is in centimeters, this would be cubic centimeters. If length was in meters, it'd be cubic meters. You know the drill.